A treat to have a long-time Bill Keith on the stage. We have done a lot of workshops together, a lot of banjo workshops have happened on the stage here at the Creekside. And I know Bill's done a lot over at the Grassroots stage as well, so it's really, really great to see all of his friends showing up today for this banjo summit. Who would have thunk it, right? We've got a couple guys that are leading this off today here at the Beard Guitar, D'Addario String, Creekside Stage. Tony Trischka, no stranger to the stage. He worked hard at this today. He's been real busy here today. He's got a real love for the banjo, and helping him out is Mr. Bela Fleck. And they're gonna take it out from here. Thanks for showing up, and please give them a great big welcome.
Hey, everybody.
Hey.
Well, we're just here to embarrass Bill Keith and ourselves. That's our goal. And we're going to mangle a bunch of Bill Keith's wonderful music for you guys and Bill today. That's our plan. Isn't that right, boys?
I'm the chief mangler.
Are you with me?
And most of us wouldn't be up here today without Bill. That's for sure.
Can we just check these real quick that we can hear these mics? I don't think these are on yet. This is going to be very unrehearsed, and then every once in a while, very rehearsed. So, you want to start?
Yeah, this is when Bill started developing. You want to say anything about Devil's Dream, since you're right there?
Yeah, I first heard this tune played by a Nova Scotian fiddler, and it just dawned on me. I could see in my mind how to play it in a melodic style. And fortunately, it was a simple tune, because if anything more complicated, then it might not have happened.
How old were you then?
Gee, probably 21.
A legal banjo age.
So, I wonder if there is anybody out there that that doesn't know exactly what we're talking about when we talk about Bill Keith's style, which is sometimes oversimplified to being playing fiddle tunes on the banjo, but it's a whole lot more than that. But is there anybody who could elegantly explain the fiddle tune part of it? Maybe Tony Trischka.
Well, we'll just just to say that when you're playing okay, it's a banjo workshop. Suddenly, I'm sorry, we're going to geek out for just a second. Bear with me. When you're doing Scruggs style, a lot of the notes are not melody notes. They're just kind of filler notes, like you take the chord and just break it up into the individual notes. In the melodic style that Bill developed and created on his own and popularized when he was with Bill Monroe back in 1963, he came up with a style which was based on scales, which suddenly allowed you to play fiddle tunes note for note, which is why...
Let me throw in that the amazing thing about this way of playing scales is that you still have alternating strings, which is what makes Scruggs style so cool, is that you have all the strings ringing into each other. So yeah, you could do a scale. But if you want the sound of the great thing about Scruggs style, the ringing, you do it like Bill did. Alternating strings almost in a backwards fashion, an unintuitive sort of fashion to find the notes and alternate with other open strings and other closed strings to make it ring like Scruggs style does.
If any of you said something wrong, you might be able to interrupt.
Anybody can interrupt.
Anytime.
I'm hoping someone will interrupt. Is that pretty good?
Yeah.
Is that a start?
Yeah.
And when I say oversimplified, I think that that's just the technique. But what Bill has brought to the banjo is so much more. From the jazz chords and but mostly an elegance in his playing. I've always just loved the musicality of what you do on the banjo. Is so the technique is one thing, and we always talk about Earl Scruggs starting the three finger style. But if he didn't play, there's other guys who played three finger around that time. But it was the musicality that is why we're still talking about, and I think that's also true of Bill. So we're going to, well, should we move on into an actual song?
Yeah.
But did we introduce everyone up here?
Let's do that.
We did not. That's Mr. Ryan Cavanaugh on the end right there. Yeah. And Mark Horowitz over here. I'm Noam Pokelny. Bela Fleck.
Mr. Tony Trischka. We're actually all related in some weird connection of teacher, student, friend, inspiration, irritation, all those things. So it's cool to be up here with you guys. We're going to attempt to mangle, first of all, the tune that that Bill first did with Bill Monroe, Devil's Dream, and we might go into Sailor's Hornpipe and mangle that as well, if that's okay with everybody. Okay.
Yeah.
You want to be the primary mangler?
All right.
Thank you.
here's a note from Steve Martin, the banjoist, writer, actor, comedian.
That one.
There is Earl Scruggs, there is Pete Seeger, and there is Bill Keith. They are the towering founders of modern banjo playing. That's a quote. Are we embarrassing you enough yet, or should we step it up a little bit?
Is my face red yet?
We're going to get Noam to do something here now.
Yes. First off, it's an honor to be up here. Thanks to everybody who put this together. Thank you to Bill for the seed.
Thank you, Noam.
I got into playing banjo because I was attracted to the music of the progressive players, and that path started with Bela and Tony, and I sought out the music of Bill Keith, and it's been one of the joys of my career to get to know Bill better, and over the last few years doing the New York banjo tour and hearing Bill play every night and hearing all the stories has been something I really cherish. So I say that because I'm going to make a lot of mistakes on this next song, and I want to leave a good impression.
Maybe you should have said that after the song.
That's right. I'll say it again. This is a tune of Bill's called Beating Around the Bush. And he makes it sound pretty easy, and it's pretty damn hard.
This could be a mangling situation. We'll just see.
Thank you.
Ouch, ouch, ouch. So I was the chief mangler on that one. But before Noam actually has a gig, he's going to have to run off in a couple of minutes. Is there anything you want to say about that song, or Bill wants to say about that song, or where that title came from? Beating Around the Bush?
Beating Around the Bush, the title just came, it's an expression, and it just seemed appropriate at the time. And I haven't written a lot of pieces of music, but that's one of my favorites. And, you know, in some ways, I think the level of difficulty adds to my enjoyment of a piece of music.
Do you mean watching us squirm?
And I think it met its match with you guys. Beautiful. Very nice.
Stick around if you want to.
And maybe let's read one more quote, shall we?
Hey, let's have a quote.
And this is from Murphy Henry. It's not only the men who have been influenced by Bill Keith. I am just one of the many female banjo players who owes a great deal to the musical prowess of this master of the five string. Bill Keith was my door into Scruggs style banjo playing. As a newbie, I didn't yet know about Bill, but I had the Earl Scruggs banjo book. Knowing just enough about reading music to hurt my playing, I found I could only make sense of the tabs by slowing down vinyl LPs of Earl's playing. I would figure out as much as I could and then turn to Bill's immaculate tabs to see if I got it right. I trusted Bill's tabs with my entire banjo being. Later on, I came to greatly admire Bill's own playing. Much later, I got to meet Bill himself and hear all about the circle of fifths. Yeah. Has anyone mentioned that yet? I always felt honored to be in his mighty presence, and I am with you all in spirit today.
Oh. Ah, cool. I would like to introduce this next gentleman, because he was actually my second banjo teacher. I took lessons in New York City from Eric Darling, who's a banjo player who's
he replaced
Pete Seeger in the Weavers. And at a certain point, he said, "You need to go learn the Keith style. I have nothing else to teach you." And I was like, "What's that? It sounds like sprockets. I don't understand. What's the Keith style?" I didn't know it was a person. It sounded, I didn't know what it was. But anyways, he said, "You need to go see if Mark Horowitz will teach you." And Mark Horowitz knows everything about everything. And so I got in touch with Mark, and he agreed to a visitation, and I came out to Staten Island, where he was. No, it was Brooklyn at the time.
Yeah.
And a long train ride out there. And he proceeded to dazzle me with every kind of banjo style that existed, and he could demonstrate Tony's playing. He could do had an encyclopedic understanding of all the banjo players from Don Reno, Alan Mundy, everything basically. If I wanted to know it, he knew it, and I was really fortunate to have him as a teacher. And one of the things he had was a lot of great tapes, and he was always telling me about Bill and having me listen, the privilege of hearing these secret tapes of Bill Keith that maybe he doesn't even know or remember about, playing some of these amazing things that either weren't on records or weren't on records that way, or just a great way to hear. So anyway, I'm just going to hand it over to you and let you say what you want and play you want.
Referencing the tapes, Bill, I just spoke of.
Mark Horowitz.
I'm keeping my hat on so my head doesn't blind you. Bill was 15, I think, when he started coming to me. I got a call from Eric Darling. He said, "I have this kid I can't teach anymore, and I have nothing to teach him, and I want to send him to you." And I said, "What's his name?" He said, "Bela Fleck." I said, "Really? What's his name?" He said, "No, really, Bela Fleck." And so this fresh-faced young 15-year-old came out to my house, and after the first lesson, after Bela left, my wife said, "How was it? How was he?" I said, this kid's very quick. And after a time, a year, year and a half or so, it got to the point where Bela had been asking me to show him so much of Tony's stuff that I was like working it out from Tony's records and then teaching it to Bela a few days later. So finally I said, here's Tony's phone number, why don't you give Tony a call? I think it's time you went on to see Tony.
But before that happened, you taught me so much stuff about the whole banjo world, and very importantly, Bill's stuff.
Well, Bill and I go back to probably 1964 or so, and in 1965 he played Gertie's Folk City on West 4th Street in New York, now long gone, with Jim Rooney, his longtime playing partner. And David Grisman happened to be in town at that time and was with them for the whole week as well. And I called Bill and asked him if I could bring a tape recorder down to Gertie's and record some of the shows. So he and Jim agreed. And I lugged my brother's Robert's reel-to-reel tape recorder in on the subway with my banjo and a microphone. And Rooney, if you recall, duct-taped my microphone to the stand for the house microphone, and that was my recording setup. At any rate, I was fortunate enough to set up the machine in the basement where the guys had their dressing room, along with the gigantic cockroaches, which I'm sure you remember. And Bill was gracious enough to play a bunch of stuff into this tape recorder. And I've treasured that tape down through the decades as one of the most amazing resources that I've ever had access to learn Bill's style. One of the tunes he played in that cellar on that hot summer night with cockroaches the size of dinner plates scurrying over our feet was a Ricketts hornpipe. And I'm going to essay to play this with my 68-year-old fingers. Incidentally, in 1966, I entered the only banjo contest I ever entered, which was at the Philadelphia Folk Festival. Now, Bill was one of the judges, happily. And I won it. By playing first this tune and then another of Phil's tune that was on that tape. So thank you, Bill. A funny sidelight, Marty Cutler, who many of you know is a great banjo player as well, also entered the contest that year along with me. And when I had my turn and I came off the stage, Marty came over to me and ruefully smiled and said, "You got it. You got it." And I said, "Why?" And I don't know. He said, "How do you know that?" He said, "Well, when you were playing, Bill and Richard Green was sitting there going like this." I never forgot that. Anyway, I'm probably going to mess this up, but I'm going to give it my best shot. Ricketts Hornpipe.
Is Mike Mumford here somewhere? Hey, Mike, come up here. We want to have you get involved.
Where is he?
Yeah, that's a hard piece. That it's just full of these triplets that are just so awkward, and somehow they
especially with sticky, you know, summer hands.
It was always hard.
I also
hey, Matt.
I also want to mention that Bill Keith won the 1961 Philadelphia Folk Festival Banjo Contest by playing Bill Keith's arrangements of Devil's Dream and Sailor's Hornpipe.
Another tune on that tape, that infamous basement tape, was Bill's version, or version that Bill had of Black Mountain Rag. I don't know, was that what you called it back then, or was...
I think so.
You had learned it from somebody else up in New England, I think, or was inspired by somebody?
I heard Don Norman from Atlanta.
Oh, okay. Well, it's a variation on Black Mountain Rag, in the good old Rubens Train low D tuning. Ready?
Black Mountain Rag played in G, and in the G tuning, the first and fourth strings are tuned to D, which is the fifth of the chord, of the open chord. Mark just played it in the D tuning, which makes the first and fourth strings the root of the chord. Vela actually wrote a tune, which is pretty much Black Mountain Rag, Green Mountain Hop, no.
A Blue Mountain Hop, yeah.
Blue Mountain Hop. And it's tuned to an open, let's see, the
B flat.
Yes, yeah. The first and fourth strings are still D, but they're now the third of the chord. And that was the only part of the chord left. So I admire that creativity. And it was remarkably easy to play for the left hand.
Yes. Yes. That's why I did it. Cool. Okay, who's next on the hit parade? Mike, you want to do some stuff?
Sure.
No songs, that's right. No, I just want to say that man, Bill's music is huge influence on me for sure. And when I started hearing his music in about 74 or 75, the Mule Skinner album had just come out maybe a year or so before that. If I have that, that's a classic record. Surely is. And I remember there was Opus 57 on there, Roanoke. I can't remember all the other tunes, but a lot of the other stuff is out of print. You know, like Sailor's Hornpipe and things like that. I couldn't really find that. But Opus 57 really kind of made an impression. So anybody want to play along?
I might be able to hang in there.
I'm sure you'll do fine.
You just
I remember.
It actually is, the title is Opus 57 in G minor. It's a David Grisman instrumental.
I remember meeting Mike. I remember meeting Mike down at the Baltimore Bluegrass store. We did some workshops there. That you organized, and I thought that was really great.
Yeah, we had Bill for a 2-day workshop. It was amazing, an impressive amount of information coming our way. I don't think we absorbed it all, but I don't think anybody could. But it was great to have Bill. That was our first workshop we had with you, Bill, in 78. Yeah, that was great. I think we had Tony on a couple of those, too. So, Matt, thank you for all your influence, that's for sure. Legendary influence on this instrument, Bill Keith. Try a little of this Opus 57.
I'll put that little B flat in there.
Okay. Yeah, you just do it. I'm going to try
start with this little kind of thing here. Thank you.
I have a question. Didn't you do that with the capo with the third fret? Out of an E minor position?
Probably. Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Yeah, I just wondered. Was that... we did it...
I should have done that.
No, you should have. I learned it both ways, too. I learned it both ways, because... do you want to tell us anything about that? What we just did, or about Roanoke we're about to do?
Well, that tune was written by David Grisman, and we learned it in his fifth floor walk-up down in the village that had DC electricity.
Edison system.
It was the old system, really, and you had to have an inverter if you wanted to run a radio or a lot of appliances that required AC. Anyway, we used to get cans of dulce de leche, which was a sweet Argentinian, I think. It's caramelized milk, and
it's the best thing on earth. Yeah,
it's very good. And we went up there and managed to find a way to make it even better. It got pretty cloudy and smoky in the room, but we managed. David wrote the tune, but I was assisting and putting my little bits and pieces in where they seemed appropriate. And then we recorded it. And then finally, it got onto a larger... It was recorded on tape.
Was that with Artie Rose playing guitar in that tape?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, I had that tape.
It reached its... the best version was, I thought, was when we recorded it with Will Skinner.
An awesome recording.
So, thanks for playing it. It was nice to hear it again. You know, I can't play because my hand is cramped up and I can't close the fingers, which means I can't make chords. I'd love to actually play a few tiny little pieces of something for you guys, but this hand is working fine. Close the fingers all the way. I can't close the fingers any further than this. So, and that's not enough to make a simple chord. So, I'm a little disabled here, but
we'll carry it.
These gentlemen are certainly all added together. They play a whole lot more than I could even at my prime. So,
not true. Yeah, but no, you got to practice these songs. To mangle them.
Could be very dangerous. That's something you
just said. Yeah, we can't just play these off the top of our heads.
Well, anyway, I'm real glad and honored that they're all here. Every one of them is a
writer. Honored that you're here, Dave.
Every one of these guys is a close personal friend, and I'm sure glad that they are able to contribute the greatest part to this event. So let's have a hand for everybody.
Okay, Mike, you're on. What do you got, Mike?
Roanoke was the other tune on that.
Yeah.
I really love Bill's playing on this tune, so join in on some Roanoke.
Yeah.
You know, this is Roanoke is a mandolin tune written by Bill Monroe, and I still remember, we used to play it every now and then when I was with the band. And at one point I could just hear again, I could see in my head just how it laid out as a melodic tune. And so I practiced it backstage. And the next time we went out, I said, Bill, give me a break on Roanoke. And he did, and that's what happened.
We'd like to bring up a gentleman who is responsible. He took over Banjo Camp North this year, so any of you have been there. I would like to bring up Mike Kropp right now.
Well, thank you.
And maybe we'll read one more quote from Alan Mundy while we're getting set in. He said, I can remember clearly hearing Bill Keith for the first time. It was on a Saturday morning folk music show when Bill Monroe's recording of Devil's Dream was played. For me, his playing was pure magic, just as magical as the playing of Earl Scruggs had been, maybe even more so. It is all still that same magic to me all these years later. Thank you, Bill Keith, for giving me and so many others something so wonderful to do with our lives, trying to play the banjo like you.
I just want to tell everyone how honored I am to be part of this. I've known Bill for a very long time and in lots of different ways, actually. Our first musical encounter years ago, I was a producer for Columbia Records, and I was doing working with Pete Seeger, producing some stuff with him, and I was doing some folk rocky stuff, and we needed a pedal steel player, so I called Bill. And you know, I think that's another facet of Bill
that
hasn't even been mentioned, but fabulous pedal steel player. And I once asked him to explain to me. He said, "Bill, what's the deal on the pedal steel?" And 4 hours later, actually, we were at the Philadelphia Folk Festival, and we just kept talking. And then Bill goes, "You know, I have to get back and play." And I think we were 2 hours away from the festival at the time, but I learned everything I needed to know. But I love you. It's just great to be here and be part of this. So.
Thank you, Mike.
Shenandoah Breakdown. Yeah. Anybody want to jump in on Caravan?